Attorney Dennis. Good afternoon.
Hello, good afternoon, Linda, Adele.
And then congratulations for a very good, I understand, impromptu closing argument on your part. What prompted, before you go into the question raised by Karen, what prompted you to, or the defense team to let you answer a portion of that?
Well, actually, I was instructed to be on standby since last night because they were already preparing their closing arguments and well, I was given the unenviable task of responding to certain matters that will not be covered in the prepared arguments by both our closing speakers. And well, at about after the Dean de Los Angeles finished, while he was actually giving his closing argument, I was informed that Justice Cuevas wanted me to speak for 10 minutes and respond to whatever Congressman Tupas has already said and what Congressman Fariñas will be saying. So at that point, I was just groping for the issues that I think were relevant. And to me, I think what first came to mind is marami pala kayong gustong tanungin eh. Bakit ganun? Ba't hindi nyo krinos-examine? That was the first thing that actually crossed my mind. And I was just acting on instinct at that point, thinking that, you know, if we wanted to settle these issues, then you should have impeached him. Hindi yung palalagpasin nyo and then all of a sudden, pag wala na siya dyan, sasabihin mo sinungaling ka.
Yeah. Okay. The in particular yung point about the use of Congressman Fariñas's palusot, it was very you know, it connected very well. It resonated with a lot of people, kahit sina Senator Enrile, natatawa. Do you feel that it hurt your case, Chief Justice's case?
Well, ang ano naman namin dun is that kung ang palusot mo naman eh hindi base sa batas, yeah, I would call it a palusot. But it is based on law. It's anchored on a provision of law that remains valid, is still existing, and has never been ruled upon to be contradictory to the Constitution. So I don't get the point why it will be called the palusot when in fact it raises a valid legal issue.
On that point, si Senate President Enrile naman raised the question of there is no prescription or prohibition on the part of the depositor from disclosing his own account. So parang bakit hindi na lang, let's say, kinonvert into pesos yung amount ng dollar accounts if there was really secrecy that he intended to observe or follow and disclose it anyway?
Well, one of the points of the secrecy of the bank accounts is that of course, the depositor does not want to shout out to the whole world that I am a rich man, that I have so much money in deposits. Because even the chief told us that he was actually fearful that, you know, people might actually plan against him or his family members for possible kidnapping, extortion, robbery, and all these things. But these are the practical consequences of confidentiality. And you cannot blame him for actually relying on it. Now, on the point that why didn't he even volunteer? Because he's being required to report in the SALN. The issue now would be, what kind of absolute confidentiality would that mean? It would become meaningless eh, if you're going to say that the public official has to disclose it because the SALN law requires it. Then what's the point of the confidentiality? The absolute confidentiality of foreign currency deposits does not say that it only applies to private individuals or corporations. Since it does not distinguish, then we're not supposed to distinguish that if you're a public official, you're not covered by the absolute confidentiality. You're covered by the SALN law. I don't think that is actually the case because even Dean de Los Angeles was very clear that in Republic versus Eugenio and subsequent cases that came after that, the right to information, which includes public disclosure by public officials of their assets and liabilities, does not prevail over the right to privacy, which includes the secrecy of bank deposits. If there is a requirement or if there is a state necessity to look into those bank secrecy bank deposits, then an amendment is necessary. That up to that point, the Supreme Court decisions are clear.
Dennis, before Adele asks you a question, I just wanted to ask also or to note that both Speaker Belmonte and Congressman Tupas in his earlier closing arguments mentioned the phrase Chief Justice illegally amassing wealth.
Mm-hmm.
Was this something that you expected, and how do you respond to that? Because up to this point, illegal, ill-gotten wealth was not supposed to be an issue here.
That is grossly unfair. I said in my closing argument that not a single person came to court and said that I bribed the chief. So how can they even say that it is ill-gotten just because of the size of the amount? But he said he was depositing these dollars since the early the late 60s. That's what he said, and that is the only evidence on record. He said that he commingled funds belonging to corporations and members of his family to get the prime interest rate. But isn't that true? Don't we do that? Don't family members actually do that? Hinahabol mo yung pinakamalaking interest rate. So, to me, that would be an unfair conclusion, because it would not be in accordance with the facts established in this case.
Okay. Well, Attorney Manalo, first, good work. I think that you and Congressman Fariñas were the exceptional speakers on both sides. But let's talk about Senator Enriles' first statements. When the proceedings opened, his first question was to Justice Cuevas in regard a possible either amendment or new petition to the Supreme Court questioning perhaps the jurisdiction of the impeachment tribunal. During the break, and you had a chance to confer with your fellow defense panel, was this a cause of concern that Senator Enriles seemed to be concerned about the statement of Justice Cuevas that he would appeal the case to the Supreme Court?
Well, that is a legal theory that Justice Cuevas has in his mind. But as far as the defense panel is concerned, we are focused on winning this case before the Senate. To me, that would be putting the cart before the horse. So we don't want to go into that kind of analysis yet, because we're still not there. We're still waiting for a verdict. And maybe it's just Justice Cuevas speaking his mind. That is his legal opinion insofar as this case is concerned. There may be some legal basis to it. But maybe once the defense panel will have a post-verdict meeting, we can probably look at the different scenarios and see what is best.
Okay. Well, Attorney Dennis Manalo, thank you for joining us this afternoon. We just want to lead into the press con of the prosecution in the meantime. Thank you. We'll see you later, Attorney.
Marami ring salamat.